All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Tierra Brooks, and we thank you for attending the webinar for our 2023 National School-Based Healthcare Conference, Preparing for Advocacy Day. This webinar will be led by my colleague, Suzanne Mackey, Vice President of Policy and Public Affairs at School-Based Health Alliance. The School-Based Health Alliance is a DC-based nonprofit and serves as the national voice for school-based healthcare. Since 1995, SBHA has supported and advocated for high-quality healthcare in schools. Our focus includes policy, standards, data, and training to support and grow school-based healthcare, particularly in SBHCs. Just a few reminders, all attendees are in listen-only mode. However, we would love to hear your questions. You can use the Q&A icon that appears at the bottom of your control panel, or you can also use the chat box. Please select all panelists and attendees before typing your message. Also, if you'd like to use the closed caption button, it is located at the bottom of your screen also. Our objectives for today, we first prepare for successful meetings with legislative staff, understand the importance of advocacy and maintaining relationships with legislative offices. And last, learn about SBHA federal policy and priorities. Our presenters for today include, once again, my colleague, Suzanne Mackey from School-Based Health Alliance, Maureen Hinman, Executive Director for Oregon School-Based Health Alliance, Sarah Murphy, Executive Director for New York School-Based Health Alliance, and Meg Gilley, Principal, the Vogel Group, and Brad Howard, Principal at the Vogel Group. Also, we would like to definitely welcome everyone to be sure you join us for our super excited for our 2023 conference, Celebrating and Growing the Workforce. The conference will take place June 26th through the 29th at American University in Washington, DC. We can't wait for everyone to share their work and have the opportunity to network together again in person. I will now turn it over to my colleague, Suzanne Mackey.
Thanks, Tierra, and welcome everyone. As Tierra said, we are very excited to be back in person for our conference this year. We are designating Thursday, June 29th as Capitol Hill Day, but you are welcome to meet with your legislators whichever day that week is most convenient to you and your state group. The House and Senate will not be in session that week, meaning the members of Congress will not be in DC, but their staff will be, and that is who you would meet with regardless of whether they were in session or not. I'm happy to be joined today by some very experienced state affiliate leaders, Maureen Hinman from Oregon and Sarah Murphy from New York, who've done many Hill visits over the years and are going to share a bit about their experience and some advice for those of you who are newer to this experience. In addition, we are very fortunate to work with some excellent outside lobbyists at the Vogel Group here in DC, and they are going to give us an overview of what's happening in Congress right now related to healthcare and our priorities for school-based health centers, which will provide some really helpful context in your meetings. So before we start with the how of doing Hill visits, let's start with the why. Why do we advocate? As with all issues, members of Congress rely on their constituents and groups to educate them and inform their positions. School-based health centers are not a widely understood issue. So unless we are educating Congress, they won't understand the value of the model. And we need that to grow their support. You can begin scheduling your meetings now. We've given state leaders access to a database with contact information for all congressional staff. You can also simply call the DC office of your House member or senator and ask for the contact info of the health staffer, saying you are a constituent and requesting an in-person meeting when you're in town next month. When you schedule meetings, be mindful of timing. there are three different House office buildings and three different Senate buildings. It can take some time to figure out where you are going once you're up on the Hill. The House and Senate are about a half a mile apart. Stay flexible. Staff may need to adjust your meeting time or who you are meeting with. Given that it's recess, it's probably a little less likely that last minute things will come up. Don't be surprised if staff are wearing jeans. The Hill is pretty quiet and casual in recess. Depending on where you are coming from, you can access the Hill via two metro stops. Capitol South is on the blue and orange line and is on the House side, and Union Station is on the red line and closest to Senate buildings. You can also take an Uber or taxi. That's very easy, very common. I do not recommend driving up to the Hill as public parking is challenging. You will need to go through security, so be prepared. That can take some time. You can bring things like water and snacks, but just no weapons or things like that you wouldn't bring on a plane. Lastly, be prepared for weather. So it's June in DC, which means that it's likely going to be hot and humid. There could be rain, and it's a lot of walking. It's more walking than you think it's going to be. So make sure that you wear comfortable shoes. If you take away nothing else from the webinar, wear comfortable shoes. That's probably the best tip. This is a map of Capitol Hill with the metro stops. As you can see, the House office buildings on the left side. So the House office buildings are Rayburn, Longworth, and Cannon. So all the members of the House have their offices in one of these three buildings. The Senate buildings are Russell, Hart, Dirksen. The House and Senate buildings are about a half mile apart, and you can see the actual Capitol building is in the middle. So keep that in mind as you're scheduling. So as I said earlier, Congress is in recess during the week of the conference. And so the members themselves will not be around. But Hill visits are almost always with staff, regardless of whether Congress is in session or not. So you will be meeting with staff. You will probably meet with a legislative assistant. Most offices have a number of legislative assistants that each have a different portfolio of issues. You will likely be meeting with the health legislative assistant. That's who you want to make sure that you are scheduling your meetings with. As I said earlier, at the last minute, that could change. You may end up having a meeting with another staff person or someone more junior. Be flexible and just go with the flow. Don't be disappointed. Try not to be disappointed that you're not going to have a meeting with the member themselves. I know it's nice to have a photo op and speak with your House member or senator, but it really is the staff who do the work, who know the issues and really have the power to advance change and progress on these issues. So you want to make sure, as part of preparing for your meeting, that you do your research. So not only does that help prepare for your meeting with that member, but it also kind of helps you prioritize and strategize who to meet with while you're in town, because you're not going to have time to meet with all House offices in your state. So it helps when you do background research to kind of figure out, okay, who should I prioritize to have a meeting with? Who is on key committees? Who is on the Appropriations Committee? Have they visited an SBHC? There could be a new member of Congress who it might make a lot of sense to invest in a meeting with them if you've never spoken with them about SBHCs in the past. So this is an important part of the process. Make sure that if they have visited an SBHC in the past or signed on to a letter in support, that's an important point of contact when you're meeting with staff. So make sure that you acknowledge all of that. Thank them for the letters that they've signed on to and site visits and things like that. And it shows the staff that you have done your background research, which means a lot. In terms of materials, bringing a one pager or two, I think is great. Make sure you bring your business cards and that you get the business cards of the staff on your way out. And that way you can make sure that you follow up with them, et cetera. Okay, so remember that you are the expert of what you are there to talk about. So you are there to tell the story of SBHCs in your community, what they are, what is the impact and value of SBHCs to the schools and students that are served, and what is the connection to federal policy. So at some point in the conversation, staff are going to want to know how they can help you. What's the connection with why you're in their office? So they're expecting that to happen at some point in the meeting, right? To have the ask come up. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in depth. Stories plus data make a serious impact. One without the other, I think, does not work as well. But I think when you combine both, it's very effective. Really important, don't make assumptions about knowledge on the part of staff. There will be some offices that do have a good understanding of SBHCs, but a lot might not really understand the distinction of an SBHC versus school nurse, school health services in general, et cetera. So it's very important to kind of take a moment to establish that 101 understanding prior to getting into more in-depth talk. The main advocacy ask that we're here to make is for SBHC appropriations. We are advocating for a total of $200 million for SBHCs in fiscal year 2024. That is what we are there to ask for. That does not need to be the focus of your conversation by any means. You were there to talk about SBHCs in your community and in your state, but make sure that at some point in the conversation that you talk about this, because they're going to want to know what you want, why you're there. So a little bit more about appropriations. So the FY24 appropriations process is currently underway in Congress. As you may know, Congress has made historic investments in SBHCs in the past couple of years. This started a few years ago in FY21 with $5 million, grew to $30 million in FY22, and then now we're at $50 million in FY23. As you may also know, all of this funding has so far been exclusively for SBHCs within the Section 330 Health Centers program. So SBHCs that are sponsored by an FQHC. We have consistently advocated for funding for all sponsor types, and our FY24 ask is for $200 million total, $100 million for SBHCs in the 330 program, the FQHC sponsored programs, and $100 million for all other sponsor types. So meeting follow-up. So as you wrap your meeting up, make sure to follow up with a thank you email. Don't wait too long to send the thank you note. Whatever additional information you talked about or resources, make sure that you include that. And really, you know, don't just think of this meeting as a one-off. If you really want to build a effective relationship that is of use to you and your field, you have to maintain some amount of engagement over the year. Inviting them to a site visit is a great step if they've never seen a school-based health center, or if it's been a while since they've seen one, or even just subscribing them to a newsletter. That's a very passive way of engaging them. Please share your adventures on the Hill with us. So your pictures on social media, tag at SBH for all. This is our hashtag on here for our conference. We really want to see what you've been doing and kind of share that experience. So I am now going to pass it over to Maureen and Sarah, who are going to give some of their experience from the state affiliate point of view. So Maureen, I'll start with you if you're ready, if you want to talk for a few minutes.
So those covered some of the tips I kind of had noted, but I guess I would say when I started doing this, was nervous, of course, to have these meetings. And over time, I have realized that they're just people. And the staff in particular are, you know, they usually grew up like in a town, two towns away from you or something. And so there are ways to make connections that I think help make you more memorable. So if you go in with your prepared speech, and rather than sort of having some interactions, I guess I'm recommending to have some interactions where you're getting to know them kind of as a person. You have very little time, but at the same time, you might notice a map on the wall and you can say, oh, I've done that there. Is that where you're from? Or something like that, just to make a quick connection, and that will make you more memorable. And then when we're talking about stories, I know some people have experience at the state level as well. the way that I like to think of it, if you're a school-based health center provider or partner, is to think about what would you tell your family or your friends if they said, what's really going on? Like, what are some of the issues that you're seeing? Because you can talk to these Congress people in a very similar way. You want to watch your time and have some data to go with it. But if you're like, just last week, I saw this kid that just broke my heart, or I had this amazing experience where we saw such growth among this kid that, you know, it brought tears to my eyes. Those kinds of stories are the ones that really capture the hearts of the people that you're working with. A couple more pieces about how Suzanne was talking about doing your research. And I do think that's really important. We have Senator Wyden is one of my senators that I have a relationship with. And the reason is he's really, really interested in mental health. And that's because he has a personal experience that he has shared widely, which is that he had a brother that died by suicide. And so that's a really personal thing that he talks about that has kind of guided him to focus on mental health. And so how does that relate to school-based health centers? He's created some mental health funding, and I've been able to say, can I have some input into that? Because it's like grants to schools directly. And so that gave me the opportunity to say, have you thought about school-based health centers? Have you thought about how the existing school health providers are going to connect through this grant and things like that. I have other things I could say, but I think I'll hand it over to Sarah so I don't take all the time here.
Thanks, Maureen. Yeah, now I get to go last after you guys all had all those great comments, but fine, that's fine. So I'm Sarah Murphy. I'm from New York, Executive Director of the New York State School-Based Health Alliance. So a lot of you already know me if you're state affiliates. So I'm going to speak to you as if you are basically a peer of mine. And the first thing I want to say, and I've said this before, is as a voting citizen in this country, you are a part of a democracy. You're allowed to talk to your legislative representatives anytime you want to. This is not something that is limited to your job. This is what you get to do. So take advantage of that, you know, realize that this is part of what we do. And as Suzanne had said, if they don't know what your issue is because they have literally about 10,000 issues, then they can't help you. So if you want to talk about a topic that's important to you individually or as part of your job, then do it. Take advantage of this. So, you know, this is a part of our job, but it's not really, it's not performative. It's not theater. You don't have to wear formal wear. As Suzanne said, a lot of them will be wearing jeans. This will be young staff members. It's really more of a strategic discussion, strategic because you have to be aware of the time. So once you realize that, this is a discussion you've had before with all kinds of people who've said, what's a school-based health center? You've done this. So relaxed, deep breath. You know, when you're going to get in the office, it's fine. You're going to be fine. You set the tone. Obviously, I use a lot of comedy, as a lot of my peers know. And I tend to ask them where they're from. I try to come across as very genuine, very talking to them and not at them. So hopefully, you know, you recognize, as Suzanne and Maureen had both said, is this is the start of a relationship. It's a relationship with this office. People in it, it's great to get to know them. But the goal here is that this particular office, this representative body, knows what a school-based health center is. So I'm just going to say right now, probably one of the most important things you have to do, because this field is young, is you say the words school-based health centers 10 times. You can say SBHC too, but school-based health centers, if they get nothing else out of the meeting, they remember, oh yeah, school-based health centers, that's important. Do that. That's really important for you to do. So I'm just going to give you some of my tips and tricks, because I don't want to waste time, because you've got a lot more to hear from the professionals. One thing that they did say to do was is to take a look at who these representatives are. They're right. Look at the bio letter. Read what they wrote about themselves, and take anything that you can find some alignment on, where they went to college, where they currently grow up, what they find important, what their topics are. Is it mental health? Is it reproductive services? Whatever it is, find it, use it, pay attention to that, because that will be alignment that's important to do. Suzanne was correct in saying a simple fact sheet. Do not try to solve the world's problems with a fact sheet that has so much text on it that no one's gonna read it. I mean, I wouldn't either. If somebody hands me something that's 11 pages and the font's point is an 8-point, am I looking at that? No, and nor are they, because you have to remember that you are probably meeting number 10 of 32 meetings on 30 different topics. So you have to make an impression, but you're not trying to get everything done in one go. This is the start of a relationship. So think about it that way. Give them something more in the email when you thank them. Write down your points. I'm doing it right now. I'm referring to bullet points. Write your bullet points and take them with you. And by the way, practice. We all have cell phones now. Film yourself saying what you want to say and see what it looks like. Do you too much? Try not to. Do you rush? I'm a rusher. Try not to rush. Calm down. A pause is just fine. You can do that. Pauses are good. They also allow for the staff to actually talk. I usually tend to ask them a question about where they're from. And Maureen was saying the same thing. Is around the office, ask them something. They might be from two towns over. Sometimes you get a staff member who's a talker. Let them talk. So, and you know, Maureen, say any sentence to me at all that's truthful. Tell me the sky is blue.
Montana is big sky country.
Maureen, that is exactly right. That is exactly why we're here to talk to you about this. That's what you do. You turn it around and you give them that little nugget of how important they are to the conversation. And then you continue on with it. That's why school-based health centers, 1, 2, and 3. So use your opportunities to do that. I've had a couple of talkers and I was actually surprised. Just let them talk. If they remember me because they got to talk, great. That was really the whole point of it. Make eye contact. Make sure that you're not just going like this, reading off your list and going really fast and nobody knows. Don't do that. It's a conversation. It's two-way. Let them see you. And use your skills. If you're good at comedy, use that. If you're a great speaker, use that. If you are emotive, if you are a great storyteller, use that. If you're bringing a group with you, make sure that you go over the ground rules and you practice. And I will tell you, this is something that I know well, is this: you will tell everybody in your group that you only have 2 minutes each to speak. No one is going to listen to that. They get excited, they're asked to speak, they go off. So you have to know, as the group leader, that you have to stop that. You have to be like, you know what, I don't want to interrupt because you have such great things to talk about, but we got to make sure we let this next person talk. Tony, what's your thoughts on this? You have to do it. You just have to be, you're the goalkeeper, all right? So just make sure that you're doing that. Make sure that you have facts that are relevant to them in their district. You can broaden from there, but what they want to hear about is the people who vote for them, the families in their district. That's what they want to hear about. How is this relevant to this legislator? If you can say, we have 8 school-based health centers that serve 10,000 kids right in your backyard. That's important. Make sure that you have that for you, you know, with you. It matters to them. And that's the thing that you'll see the staff writing down. The staff themselves, as Suzanne had said, don't worry about if you don't meet with the legislator. The staff are the ones who decide what goes in front of the legislator, their schedule, their policies, what they should be reviewing. Make an impression on them. That they're great. They're young. They're very savvy. give them that respect too. I have seen people go in and immediately go rogue and start yelling. And I'm like, nope. That is one way to not be invited back to a meeting. This is a respectful conversation. I don't care if they look like they are, you know, fourth graders. These are very smart young people. And so give them the respect of getting that job. And then I think that's really all of it that I wanted to cover. You know, if it goes well, great, follow up. If it doesn't go well, brush it off. I've had meetings where I thought I was dynamic and I looked up and they're looking at their watch because they want to go to lunch. Roll with it. It's just one of many opportunities to speak. So don't overthink it. Just prepare well and be flexible and smile. That's my part. And back to you, Suzanne.
Thank you both so much. That's so helpful. And I was nodding along with everything that you're saying. I think you can tell from both of you just how many times you've done this. Thank you again.
But Suzanne, can I add one thing?
Yeah.
I'm sure we've all experienced at some point the misinformation or disinformation about school-based health centers. So I just wanted to add that it's a really good idea to be prepared to answer some questions, but it's an even better idea, in my opinion, to go in there and try to address them in ways that don't acknowledge the issue. So don't say, I know everybody says SBHCs do abortions, and they don't. Don't say the word abortion. Don't say anything like that. Just go in there and say, you know, and this is where knowing the congressperson is really helpful, but say you can emphasize primary care. They provide primary care, just like a federally qualified health center, or just like whatever that congressperson focuses on. If it's mental health, they provide mental health services. If it's like, I have a representative that's on the House Education Committee, when I go talk to her, I talk about all the behavioral problems that teachers are seeing and how school-based health centers address that. And also making sure to say what they do provide as services in a way that hopefully will address that they don't do all these crazy things. Like, they do the same thing your primary care doctor might do or your kid's pediatrician might do. They are just conveniently located in the school. But I would say be prepared to address some of those sensitive topics or to just kind of defer. And I don't know if you want to say anything else to that, Suzanne.
Maureen, I just wanted to add to that. You're right. The disinformation piece is best addressed by answering the question before it's asked, filling in what they do before you go into all these crazy things of what they may or may not do. Absolutely. And when you address it ahead of time and you inform them, you're not spending your time refuting. You've already told them what they do. And then if it comes up, then yes, then you address it. But agreed, because it's easier to inform ahead of time than it is to try and battle a rumor. Rumors, once they're spoken, especially repetitively, have a lot of power. So I totally agree with that one.
Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah, I do think that that's an important point. I think we have to be aware of the broader context, political and cultural context that we're in right now, and that there is a lot of stuff going around about school-based health centers and school health services and, the rights of parents. So that is real. I will say, I think that even in the office of the most conservative member, I don't think that the staff are going to want to launch into that. I think these conversations are sort of high level, very respectful. I'd be surprised if the staff were really kind of pushing on those issues. I certainly think that talking about the importance and involvement of parents and that school-based health centers require parental consent and that, you know, a core part of the model is to engage parents and, you know, have it be this collaborative approach. I think that's certainly important to share. But I don't think that a lot of these more sensitive topics will necessarily come up. But I do think that what you have both said, I think, is helpful advice. So thanks for bringing that up. So thank you both so much for sharing your experiences. This is really helpful. So I'm going to move forward and pass it off to our partners at the Vogel Group. So the Vogel Group have been contract lobbyists for the School-Based Health Alliance for about 3 or so years, I think. They've made a lot of progress for us over the past couple of years. So we're really thrilled to have them join us. So I'm going to pass it over to Brad and Meg.
Well, thank you, Suzanne. And thanks for everyone for joining us today. Very helpful tips, Sarah and Maureen. And I can tell you, as someone who was a chief of staff to a member for numerous years and was heavily lobbied, those are great, great tips and spot on. So I wish everybody luck when they schedule and as they take on their meetings. But it's with great pleasure to join you all today. My name is Brad Howard. I'm principal at the Vogel Group. My colleague, Meg Gilly, here is another principal, and I'll let her introduce herself in a moment. But you know, I'll just start off with saying that the other folks working in our account, Bob Van Heuvelen, who is a principal and longtime Senate chief of staff, Bobby Cunningham is our director, who helped our account, helps run our account day to day. My background is about 15 years in government and politics. Most recently as chief of staff to Congresswoman Stephanie Murphy, who was a chief deputy whip in House leadership and a leader of the Blue Dog Coalition. Prior to that, I was spokesperson for the Blue Dogs, which are the moderate Democrats on the Hill, and had run several campaigns around the country. Politics is in my blood, and I enjoy what I do every day, and it's a pleasure working with your team in DC who represents you very well. We have a great partnership and a lot of success we've had working together, and we look forward to continuing that relationship. Meg, I'll let you introduce yourself.
Hey, y'all. Thanks so much for letting us join you today. I'm Meg Gilly. I'm also a principal at the Vogel Group. I also worked on the Hill for my hometown member of Congress from Southeast Georgia. He was a Republican appropriator, so very squarely in SBHA's lane as it relates to funding levels and things of that nature. I also have done some state lobbying in Atlanta and have focused primarily on healthcare issues in my 16 years, I guess now. Brad said, it's a pleasure to work with you all and very exciting. I know that SBHA is working hard to have, a wonderful conference agenda and, let us know if we can be helpful with anything.
Great. And with that, quickly, what I think is always helpful is to understand the context of the Congress you're walking into. We'll quickly go through this, kind of preview what the Congress is working on and then end with kind of a little more detail on some of the healthcare policy. Meg, our in-house healthcare policy expert, will help lead that discussion. And Meg, feel free to jump in here anywhere along the way. But very quickly, understanding the balance of power, this is key in the House. The Republicans, so last Congress, the Democrats had a 4-seat majority. This Congress, the Republicans have a 4-seat majority. I think what it's gonna show over the next decade after this round of redistricting, the House is gonna continually be up for grabs for both parties. What that means is relationships across the aisle are key. Even if your hometown member is a Democrat and you may be a Democrat and you don't ever want to work with Republicans, you never want to have that posture because you want to be prepared to adjust to any kind of flip every 2 years, which means different people have the gavels, different people in the speaker's offices, staff, different staff are in charge. So you want to maintain as much as you can positive working relationships with both sides. And when you have a majority this tight, it actually increases the power and influence of every individual member. So all Speaker McCarthy can lose are 4 votes. And then the bill goes down out of, 222. So that's a pretty heavy lift for any speaker. And Speaker Pelosi had the same issue last Congress. She had a little more flexibility because of proxy voting, which has gone away now that the pandemic is over. So Speaker McCarthy's in a tight spot. And so far he's shown a willingness to keep his caucus together and pass legislation, though. We'll watch the national debt debate, how that plays out with appropriations. He's got a tough road ahead. Next slide. Senate similarly close, but believe it or not, 51-49 is a much more comfortable margin than the Democrats had last Congress, which was 50-50. Vice President Harris had to break numerous ties over in the Senate. The Democrats technically have the three independents caucusing with them. That is Senator Angus King, Senator Bernie Sanders, and most recently, Senator Kyrsten Sinema. They're technically independents, but for terms of who runs the Senate, they caucus with the Democrats. This map will most certainly look very different in after the next election. Republicans are heavily favored to flip the Senate. The map looks pretty bad for Democrats in 2 years, or I guess in a year and a half now. But, you know, we thought we were going to lose the Senate this Congress, and we wound up growing the majority with Senator Fetterman picking up the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So I say these two slides are critical. It just goes to show you how critical it is that we maintain relations on both sides of the aisle. You understand the very partisan nature of the environment we're working in. When both parties think that they could keep or gain control of Congress, they are at their most hyper partisan. Now, I say all that to say the members have what they do on TV is very different than how they interact with their constituents. I think Matt can back me up, having worked for, you know, conservative Republican and me working for a moderate Democrat. The politics leave the door when you're talking to a constituent. When you're talking to a constituent, you understand that they have come up here to listen to you. The staff understands this too. And to Suzanne's great point, they're not going to instantly jump into divisive issues. They understand they're there to listen to you, to give you your chance to present the issues that you're passionate about, and then move on. So they're not there to argue about the things you see on cable news. That's a totally different dynamic of Congress that, you know, it has no relevancy to really what you're doing. But understand that because of the partisan, hyper-partisan nature we're in, you want to try to avoid going to those partisan pivot points as much as you can. Next slide. And again, to make it even more partisan, we have a presidential race looming this cycle in a year and a half. You've seen that there's a number of Republicans that are starting to announce this week alone. Governor Ron DeSantis of Florida, Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina. Of course, President Trump has announced he's running for re-election, with a few others. All of this is creating a lot of political dynamics. President Joe Biden has announced he's running again. You can see the tightness of these races. It's all within the margin of error. Again, the country is very evenly split right now among Democrats and Republicans. Again, it just adds to understanding just how, I don't want to say how divided we are, because, and Meg, feel free to back me up here, but like, you'd be surprised at the number of bills that actually get passed today and get signed into law. You hear these flashpoints of disagreements because that's what the media covers. But there are the House right now is passing like 20 suspension bills a week, and suspension bills require 290 votes. So that's 70 plus Democrats that are crossing the aisle to vote with Republicans. There's about 20 a week the House is passing. And that was the same way under the Democratic majority. So keep in mind that while you see the country is closely divided in terms of partisan ideology, and of course we are a political nation, that's true of any democracy. Things are getting done. And you look at the last Congress in particular, I understand Democrats had control of House and the White House, but you needed 60 votes. You needed 10 Republicans to get anything done in the Senate. We were to pass gun safety legislation. We were to pass healthcare reform, able to pass climate change. So for all the talk, I want you to go to these meetings very optimistic, because while we are closely divided, government is working to, maybe not as efficiently as we all would like, but things are getting done, and that your advocacy matters, because as these bills move and become law, you want to make sure your perspective is reflected in the legislation as much as possible. Next slide. Very quickly, the things I'll toss it to Meg we're looking at, just the new leadership. We're focused, obviously, the Senate maintained Democratic majority. However, Senator Patty Murray of Washington State left health and went to chair appropriations. She is also now president pro temp, which makes her third in line for the presidency. Ron Wyden maintained his chair of finance. And on the House side, obviously Republicans took over with Kathy Morris Rogers of Washington leading energy and commerce, which is the big committee of jurisdiction for healthcare. Jason Smith of Missouri is now leading ways and means, which does have a healthcare perspective, and particularly around worker and family support. And then Education and Workforce Committee, Virginia Fox, who's been the head of that committee for has been leading it for a while on the Republican side, obviously has some impact to what you all do there as well. So we're monitoring how these committees are coming together. Some of them are getting off to a rough start. I would actually argue energy commerce has gotten off to a very effective start. I think the Republicans and Democrats, while they disagree, are actually working very well together there. And McMorris Rogers is running a sharp operation. Jason Smith, just a little more trouble there getting Ways and Means readjusted to his leadership. Virginia Fox has run her side of that like a machine for years. So very effective there. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Meg, who is going to preview kind of what are some of the issues Congress is focusing on now, and then in particular with healthcare. But Meg, feel free.
Yeah, so June 1st, that is as soon as it sounds, that is the current deadline for the debt ceiling. If we are still talking about that when y'all are there in late June, we are all in a lot of trouble. But suffice it to say, for the time being, I'm sure seen on the news, there have been ongoing conversations, and Congress loves to wait like to the last minute to do things sometimes, especially difficult things like this. We'll see what happens, but I think it probably, they'll get to some sort of compromise where the ceiling is extended. What will be definitely going on when y'all are there is appropriations. So the chair of the Appropriations Committee and leadership have said that they want to have all 12 subcommittee bills passed before they go into August recess. And they have already begun what's called subcommittee markups, which is just essentially like it sounds, you get a bill and you strike this, you add this, et cetera, et cetera. We should definitely have seen the Labor, Health and Human Services, Education subcommittee bill and report by the time y'all get here. It may even be on the floor then, not sure, but it is usually one of, if not the last bill to go because it has so many controversial policy riders and there's always, debate on the spending levels. But the good news is y'all should know where you stand in terms of funding levels by the time you arrive in late June. It's a little bit early to talk about the potential of a government shutdown, but it's always a possibility. More likely, there'll be a continuing resolution, also known as a CR, that will take funding into December, at which time there will be a massive package that includes a bunch of other stuff that isn't even related to appropriations and, hopefully passed before January. That is not a guarantee by any means, but that's kind of where we sit and think that that'll happen. And as I mentioned, usually it'll back up to December, and there are other programs that expire, including some of these tax breaks. And so that would probably be included as well. And administrative actions, we just mentioned this because with the divided Congress, the president does have a little bit of latitude to do things via executive order. That doesn't mean that Congress likes it or doesn't disagree with it or how actually enforceable it is, but just keep a lookout on that. So, in terms of you guys, obviously there's a conversation about school-based health centers, and so the way I just to put it simply, I would explain yourselves is: are you familiar with the federally qualified health center? Yes, no. We'll say it's yes. That's essentially what we are, but in a school. That is all you got to say, and people get it. So just another tip in addition to the ones earlier. There has been a lot of conversation around mental health for the past several years, particularly with reports coming out about how affected or how impacted children have been because of the pandemic and not going to school. And then, social media and all the other different very alarming statistics about how a lot of children are becoming, mentally having trouble with their mental health. So nothing has really been done in terms of like a massive package yet. There were some grant programs that were authorized at the end of last year, but no major legislation has passed, mostly because there's some disagreement about some of the minor things, but it is something that is on everyone's radar, Republican, Democrat, House, Senate. I will just kind of briefly mention these. Actually, Suzanne, can you go to the next slide? Oh, no, that, okay, sorry, go back. Medicaid obviously is something of interest to you all. I think the big issue right now is the re-enrollment process with the end of the public health emergency. Most states are allowing up to a year to get the disenrollment kind of set straight. And a lot of them have asked for waivers from Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services. There's not a whole lot in that space other than kind of the impact of the end of the PHE and the re-enrollment process. As far as Medicare, it's, you know, set to go broke. So there's always a larger conversation about that, but no one can agree about how to fix that. I won't get too much into Medicare Advantage. Entitlement reform, we mentioned, because part of the debt ceiling negotiations, Speaker McCarthy wants work requirements for those on Medicaid. I'm sure our state lobbyists know this. That actually has been a priority of some of the more conservative states for many years now, but it's gotten caught up in court. So I'm not sure that that would even be constitutional, but we'll see. And then just quickly, it's not on the slide, but a couple other items that you might want to be aware of. We mentioned, you know, the committees above, and I agree with Brad's assessment. I thought that this year, with the passage of the Inflation Reduction Act last year, which included several health provisions, that this would be a slow year in healthcare, and I was completely wrong. I think that is in part because we do have new leadership at Senate Help and at Ways and Means, and they are having hearings 2-3 a week on just the health subcommittee. It's a lot. I think, you know, again, it's new leadership kind of trying to show a little bit moxie. The main issues though are oversight, and the target of everybody is pharmacy benefit managers. There's also some items in the way of transparency, particularly as it relates to nonprofit hospitals and their status. Still some discussions on the origins of COVID, but that's, you know, mainly, those are mainly the discussions right now. PBMs are kind of leading the way, which thankfully you guys are far away from. So that's just a, you know, more specific overview of healthcare issues. And by the way, what we're talking about now, June 27th is like light years away in like Congress's world, which is kind of weird. It's because it's only a month away for us. But, you know, some of these items could change by the time y'all arrive. And I am going to remind people to put questions in the chat, because I have not seen any yet.
Thanks, Meg. And thank you, Brad. That was very helpful. So that is the end of our little show. So we are ready for questions. So let me look in the chat. No questions. All right. I can't see you all, but
guess my boss used to say if there weren't any questions, that means she nailed the conversation, the presentation.
We all nailed it. I guess
we'll take.
All right. Okay. Well, I'll just give it another moment. If folks want to put their questions or comments in the chat, feel free to do that as well. All right.
We got one in the Q&A. Sorry, I might have said chat. I think maybe it should go to the Q&A. My fault.
Yes. Oh, yes. Sorry, I should have mentioned that. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so I saw a question. Yes, we are recording this, and we will send out those slides probably within the next week or so, and then it will also be posted on our website. So I'll make sure that everyone who's registered for this webinar gets those as soon as we can get them up. Let me look in the chat.
Suzanne, are we on questions? If I could add two more pieces of advice to your tips when you go in to meet with offices. Just keep in mind that neither the staffer nor anyone in the office can accept gifts on for taking the meeting, so not even a paperclip. So a thank you note is perfectly acceptable. The one thing they can accept, weirdly enough, is home-baked goods, but still not in exchange for an official service. So if you come in to meet and bring homemade cookies and say thank you, don't be offended if they can't take those cookies. But if just randomly you dropped off, said, thanks for public service, here's some cookies, they're allowed to take that. They can. It's really the only thing you're allowed to do. That's mainly written in because you don't want to be rude to your constituents who baked cookies for you from there. And the other thing I'll say is, again, we deal with policy figures and numbers. We deal at the macro level consistently in legislation. Humanize things. I cannot stress how important it is to tell a story, to humanize things, to go in with a very personal, real story. If you have someone who has benefited from an SBHC, those are powerful advocates. If you yourself have benefited, or you know somebody who has, or I've seen people bring in video testimonies on occasion, just however you can make sure that we're not just talking about dollars and cents here, we're talking about changing lives. And that's the stuff that sticks with members. That's the stuff they never forget. And it sticks out from the 15 meetings that they've had that day.
Yeah, and the other two things I'll mention, because I did see something in the chat, don't be nervous about any of this. Like, you literally cannot mess it up. Do not be nervous. And the other thing, you remember, Brad, with the gift ban, don't talk about fundraising. That is actually illegal for them to talk about that in the grounds of the Capitol building. They can go off campus and then they can talk about it till their face is blue, but don't talk about fundraising. And I would probably stay away from just campaign talk in general.
And keep in mind too, if you're meeting with staff, you may not get to the member, but the member is in their districts a lot. So you don't have to be in DC to meet with your member of Congress. This is a big misconception. Your member probably has an office within driving distance of where you live. And so you can set up, in addition to this, a meeting with the member in the district. And I actually thought those meetings were much more valuable because they're not 10 to 15 minute meetings. They tend to be like 30 minute meetings because they're much less rushed in the district. There's fewer events to attend and fewer vote. There are obviously no votes. So there's fewer demands on the members' time when they're in the district. Invite them out to tour an SBHC. There's different things you can do to engage the member back in the district. So like I said, don't be disappointed you don't get to meet with them in DC. The legislative staff is exclusively in DC, and they're the ones that literally the member has to take sometimes, 5 or 6 votes a day, and they can't do that all themselves. So they really rely on the staff to say, okay, I've got this vote in an hour. What are the pros and cons? Give it to me real quick. Let me know what I'm talking about here. And the staffer has to be prepared for that quick rapid fire conversation. And, if you've made an effective presentation and stuck with them, that's what they're going to advise the boss.
Thank you, Brad. I'm getting a few questions about how to set up the meetings, how to get the contact information. So I mentioned this in my slides a little earlier, but for the state affiliates, we make available to them a database with all contact information for all offices. So the state affiliates have the ability to access that. What I will also do, just to make it more efficient, because I know some people on this webinar planning on doing visits are not necessarily from a state with a state affiliate. To everyone who's registered for the webinar, I will circulate a spreadsheet of all the health staffers and their contact information for all House and Senate offices. Just that way everyone has it. The best way to contact them is just to send an email requesting a meeting, saying the dates that you will be in town, your preferred time. That's the best way of doing this. So I will make sure that that goes out with the recording and the slides. So probably sometime next week. We also got a question about one pagers on SBHCs. We do have some of that information. So we have an infographic on what is a school-based health center. We have a few specific fact sheets, I think, on mental health, et cetera. Those are available on our website, but again, for efficiency, what I will do is make sure that there's a page on our website within the conference section that has all resources related to Advocacy Day. So that will have all those one pagers, it will have these slides, et cetera. So I'll make sure that everyone who's registered for this webinar has that link. see, and yeah.
One of the things, just when you email the staffer, keep in mind these staffers get 300 emails a day. It is very appropriate to follow up every 3 or 4 days and just say, hey, I know you're busy. I want to see if you got my email. I'm coming into town and would like to schedule something. Obviously don't do it every day, but try it a couple times via email and then call the main line of the office and say, may I speak to Jane Doe? And they'll try to connect with me on the phone. Hey, I sent you an email. I just want to follow up and see, I would give it some time before you do that approach, but once a week is certainly respectable time to like kind of re-ping the email. If you're not getting a response at all, you may just call the main line again and say, hey, I'm coming up next week. I still haven't heard from staffer X. Is there somebody else I can meet with? This is a very common staffers kind of, you're not bugging the staffer. They're your constituent. They obviously want to meet. They will be grateful that you help them not miss that email so that their boss doesn't know they didn't respond to a constituent, right? So it's, don't be afraid that you're interrupting them. This is their job, is to meet with people like you. And the last thing they want is their boss to realize a constituent couldn't get a meeting. That is persona non grata in every single office on the Hill.
And if I can add, I actually have a much closer relationship with the field office staff than I do like the ones in my state, than I do with the ones in DC. So that's another option, because every time I hear there's a break, I get in touch with her and say, hey, do you think Senator Wyden would like to visit an SPHC this time? So she knows me, and that has resulted in me getting invited to meetings and things that he does in state. So that's just another option to
mention. That was typical Brad and I, only having been DC staffers, to not mention that, but you're absolutely right. And also, for that matter, invite them to some of your centers.
Yeah, the best legislative staff go back home with the boss on extended district work periods. So there's a 2-week period in April. There's a 5-week period in August. Those are the times they go back to the district and meet with people back home. So that's great to suggest that too. Like, hey, great meeting with you today. If you got some time in August and you're back in the district, we'd love to take you around. Feel free to end with that kind of ask. And usually they'll say yes, because they're always looking for stuff to do in the district.
I just responded to a question about how many visits should we schedule. So I think that depends on a lot of things. How much time do you want to spend on the Hill doing meetings? If you're staying on through Thursday, if you're able to stay that whole day, you'll have much more time. But if you're trying to sort of squeeze these in earlier in the week, and it's during conference, you'll have to kind of weigh that. I would say, personally, from my own experience of going on the Hill, 3 to 4 meetings, it's kind of a lot to do more than that in a morning or an afternoon. It's a lot of walking back and forth from meeting to meeting, and it can be draining. And so I wouldn't be a lot more ambitious than that, and be mindful of timing and scheduling. So don't schedule a meeting in the Senate side that's, starts 10 minutes after you're done from your meeting on the House side. And I would say generally, and this totally varies based on the day and how busy staff are, but I would budget about half an hour for visits. I think that's what the staff are budgeting. It could be in recess, they don't have much else going on and things are quiet, that they end up having more time to talk with you. But I would budget about half an hour. So if you have a meeting on the House side at 10, don't schedule a meeting on the Senate side at 10:30, because it's going to take you 15 minutes to walk from the House to Senate side. So be mindful of that. So I would say pick 3 or 4 meetings, I would say. If you want to do more than that, great. But that's what I would do.
My general rule of thumb, Mac and I schedule these meetings for a living, is you want to provide an hour for the whole experience. So 15 minutes, you want to get there early, which is Dan's point, 30 minutes for the meeting, and then 15 minutes to get to your next meeting, right? So kind of as you frame that, if I've got a meeting at 10 a.m., I need to be there at 9:45. I'm probably not going to leave till 10:30. And then I need 15 minutes to get to my next meeting. So if I've got a meeting at 10, you kind of want to anticipate not scheduling another meeting until 11 at the earliest. You can maybe do 10:45 if you're already on the House side, but why? You don't want to kill yourself so that you're sweating and you're rushing and you're trying to, you get lost. You want to give yourself some time to go there. So, if you did, 9, 10, and 11 on the House side and 1 and 3 on the Senate side, that's a full day.
Yeah. And I would start with your two senators and your hometown member, and then probably go to somewhere proximate to it, to that. The other thing, this is just sort of a logistics thing. There are cafeterias in most of the House and Senate buildings. So you know, if you're having some in the morning and in the afternoon, you'll have time to grab a bite. And you will have to go outside between the House and the Senate offices. But once you're in the House offices, they're all connected underground. So you won't have to keep going in and out of security, which is nice.
Yeah, and you will be on the actual campus that Suzanne showed. There's really no shade. Like, you are going to be huffing, you're going to be sweating, you're going to be excited to get in that building, and you will make a mistake or two. You'll go the wrong way in a hallway. Give yourself that time so that you don't appear to be looking at your watch while you're in your own meeting. You don't want to be like, well, I have to meet with somebody more important. Don't do that. Give yourself that time that you are dedicating to this particular meeting. Thank them very much. They may be running late, they may be running early. You have to accommodate for all that. If you've never been on the subway system in DC, you have to be prepared for that. Little tip for you, don't let go of your ticket because you needed to get out of the station, which is not what we do in New York. And I learned that the hard way. You just have to be prepared for all inevitabilities. Hopefully you won't get lightning. Usually you get, just unrelenting sunshine. So Marines, right? Light clothing, easy shoes, bring water, and then enjoy it. I know that sounds crazy to say, but enjoy it. You're doing something that you should be doing. You're doing something, as Brad said, this is your right to do this. So enjoy the process. It's something that not everybody gets to do, but should.
And I think that's a perfect note to end on. Thank you, Sarah. Thank you to Maureen, Sarah, Meg, and Brad. This was really helpful. I know we're just a couple minutes over time, so I'm going to end it there. But as I said, I will make sure that everyone who's on this webinar and has registered gets a follow-up email, probably in about a week, with the link to the recording, the contact list of staff, and a link to a page that we're going to create on our website with one pagers and all information related to Advocacy Day at conference. So thank you all so much for joining us, and have a great rest of your afternoon.
Thank you all.